It'll be a blast. So dark, 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 so d The eternal God is our dwelling place, and underneath are the everlasting arms. For we know that if this earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whosoever lives and believes in me will never die. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, because I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also. Friends, we have gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of James Earl Testerman. We come in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, and in death, resurrection. Let us pray. O God, who gave us birth, you are ever more ready to hear than we are to pray. You know our needs before we ask and our slowness in asking. Give to us now your grace, that as we shrink before the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Speak to us once more your solemn message of life and of death. Help us to live as those who are prepared to die. And when our days here are accomplished, enable us to die as those who go forth to live, so that living or dying, our life may be in you, and that nothing in life or in death will be able to separate us from your great love in Christ Jesus our Lord. O eternal God, we give you thanks for Jim's life. We thank you for the vitality of his life. We thank you for the love in his heart that was shared with family and friends. We thank you for the experiences that come rushing in at this moment in this place. And we thank you, Lord God, that you have blessed him and that you have surrounded his life with blessing. As we gather today to celebrate that wonderful life, may we be comforted by your presence. May we be assured by your word, and may we know, Lord God, that we do not walk alone, but that you are always with us. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world thy hands have made, I see the storm, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to me, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest plains I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the roar and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to me, How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take that on a cross my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to me, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall rise in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to me, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Good morning. I'm Cindy's little brother.
Ouch.
I've got to read from the Old Testament book of Ecclesiastes. For everything, there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to pluck up what has been planted. I want to come back to that line a little bit later. A time to weep, a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance. What gain have the workers for their toil? I have seen business that God has given to everyone to be busy with. He has made everything suitable for its time. Moreover, he has put a sense of past and future into their minds. Yet they cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. I know that there is nothing better for them than to be happy and enjoy themselves. As long as they live, moreover, it is God's gift that all should be eat and drink and take pleasure in all their toil. I know that whatever God does ensures forever. I said I would go back to the land of the time to plant and the time to pluck. And maybe it's not a very good correlation, but I always think of Earl. And Jim would just love to come. And I don't know what kind of what his knowledge was of farming. I'm a grain farmer on our family's farm in Wisconsin. And when Jim would come to the farm, he would love to come into the machine shed and he would look at machinery. And he would ask just dozens of questions. And he wanted to know how this worked. He wanted to know why I had three of those and only one of these. And, you know, and then the reason I think you, Earl, is I had been working on a soybean planter And he said, you know, Kent, he says, can you take some pictures of this soybean planter? He says, I want to show my dad. And I'm a shop guy, and Earl was a shop guy and a machinist. And then could you make take some pictures and do a little write-up? So I think a few years ago, Earl reviewed that once. And I just always think he wanted it. So, and then before I leave, I just want to add, I have a few lasting memories of Jim. And Jim was, as you probably already know, when you first meet him, he's not a man of a lot of words. And, you know, so I'm trying to meet this guy that is eventually going to marry my sister. But, you know, as time went on and he and I would be together, we got talking more. And we, when everybody would go to bed, he and I would have discussions. And I don't know what you'd call them, but I guess they would be discussions of life, philosophy, social behavior, current events. He was really well read, and we would go back and forth and banter a little bit and what he thought about stuff. And I'll never forget that in my life. And then the other thought I have, or this picture in my mind, who would want to meet this man on a field of competition? He's a big man. But we were snowbirding, my wife and I, Jim and Cindy, and snowbirding in Florida last year. And I got a little word, we were going to go boating with some friends, and I got a little word that Jim was nervous about going on the boat, and he wasn't sure if he wanted to do it. And he said, as long as he sees land, he'll be fine. And we got on that boat, and we were with seasoned boaters, and I kept on looking at Jim, and I could see the smile getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And we stopped at beaches and restaurants, and he was just having a blast. And I just, that's a picture in my mind of Jim. And he always, you'd hear him on the phone, he wanted to know how his bug was, how his little bug was. That's Kaylee. He just loved her dearly. I know Jim loved my sister. I know that was a fact. I know my sister loved Jim. I'll miss him dearly. We were anticipating another snowbird vacation this coming year. But I guess, I guess his wings were already ready. So I just want to part with it. Ed, Don, Earl, I'll miss your brother. I'll miss him a lot. He was a great brother-in-law.
I want to extend my deepest sympathy to Cindy, Jennifer, Tyler, Kaylee, Earl, Ed, Don, and Vernia. And I want a special wave out to Coach Don Donaher, who is here today. And he coached Jim when Jim played basketball for the University of Dayton. And thank you so much from the family. That means a lot. Thank you for being here today to honor and celebrate Jim Chesterman. My name is Mary Ray Johnson, and I'm her older friend. Okay? Yes, her younger brother, but I am the older friend, okay? From Green Bay. And Cindy and I have been friends for over 40 years. Of course, she was 2 and I was 6 when we met. I wish. But so we have a long history together of Cindy's moves to Green Bay and Cindy's moves back to the Cincinnati area. Cindy, Jennifer, and Kaylee asked me to share some thoughts and stories about the man they called husband, father, and pet. Jim had a lot of important roles in his life besides those 3. He was a son, he was a father-in-law, he was a brother-in-law, he was a brother, uncle, and friend. Jim was surrounded by love. And I know that because for the last 10 to 12 days, At the Testament household, Cindy, Jennifer, and Kaylee and Tyler have been surrounded by love. It came in the form of meals, numerous offers to help, that help them face the challenges they have had and the ones that are still to come. So thanks to those who ran an errand, brought a meal, a loaf of bread, pies, wine, cookies, soda, bottled water, whatever it was greatly appreciated. People not only rescued them with all these things, one day we almost ran out of chocolate and Diet Coke, and that would be a disaster. But sure enough, Jen sets out a message, and pretty soon everything that I requested is also there. The meals and desserts were delicious, the beverages refreshing, and the desserts so yummy, and I've eaten way too many of them this week. I am hoping that some of you will deliver meals to me in Wisconsin, because I'm going to miss that. Thank you for all you have done, and God bless you. Jim fought very, very hard to stay here with his family. The first word out of his mouth as he recovered from the heart attack was Spunk, a nickname for Kaylee. Day after day, for 10 very long days, he fought. The challenges he faced were many: heart attack, bleeding ulcer, high fever, pneumonia, stroke, and finally his kidneys screamed at him, "No more, Jim. No more fighting, Jim. It's time to go." Jim, you fought the good fight, you have finished the race, and you have kept the faith. When I think of Jim, one of the words I always think of is devoted. Jim was very devoted to one of my dearest friends. He demonstrated his devotion to those he loved. But you don't have to take my word from it, because Jim's actions speak very loudly of this devotion. When she was very, very little, Katie squealed one day, "My papa is a giant." Jim was standing up, and Kaylee walked right between his legs. She didn't have to duck. She didn't have to bend. And that was her response. To tiny little Kaylee, her papa was a giant. He was a giant of a man in Kaylee's eyes and in her heart. Jim spent 5 days a week or more with his granddaughter. He picked her up from school. They spent a lot of time together in the swimming pool. Cindy might have taught Kaylee how to swim, but it was Jim who encouraged her to practice. Jim and Kaylee, though, had some not-so-secret hiding places. Jamie, a close friend of the family, discovered this when Kaylee walked into Papa and Mimi's bedroom and offered her some chocolate-covered caramels that were cleverly hidden at the bottom of a pile of Jim's folded clothes. So it was a secret stash, wasn't it, Kaylee? Jim and Kaylee loved to take selfies. When gathering photos and memorabilia for Jim's video, we found a plethora of selfies on Jim's phone. Smiling ones, grumpy ones, pouty ones, and a lot of laughing ones. Kaylee is an extremely talented equestrian and competes in horse shows in Ohio and in other states. Jim wasn't quite a fan of the horse shows. He wasn't interested in understanding or learning about the scoring system. There was nobody stealing the ball. There were no full court presses. There was no defense. And there weren't any linebackers running over the other team. But when it came to main event horse shows, Jim was there in the stands to support her. Last year, Kaylee won Reserved Congress Champion, and Jim was there. Kaylee also played basketball. Tyler was her coach, and Jim attended every game, just as his parents did so many years ago. Kaylee Buck, your papa was a gigantic, gentle giant, and he will always be with you because he loves you with a gigantic love. Jim and his close friend Scott celebrated Monday nights together for many years as comedy night. And I was visiting Cindy and Jim on a Monday night, and I didn't know about Monday night comedy night. And since I was a big fan of Dancing with the Stars, that's what Cindy put on the TV for me. Well, Scott was upstairs fixing Jim's computer. And when Scott finished, he came downstairs for comedy night and he locked eyes on the TV and he gave Jim a look of total betrayal and exclaimed, "You're watching Dancing with the Stars on comedy night?" I don't even remember, Scott, if we changed the channel or if I got to watch my show. I just don't remember anymore. Jennifer, though, also knew about Monday evenings and comedy night. I accidentally interrupted comedy night, but Jennifer purposefully crashed it. Jennifer walked in, Jim and Scott were in their usual places. Jim all sprawled out on the couch with all five hats on top of him. Scott, meanwhile, was being stretched out on the love seat. Jim and Scott's jaws dropped at the intrusion of Jennifer. Jennifer, though, was more than happy to disrupt their guy night. Jim didn't move an inch on that couch. So Jennifer walks over to Scott, swings his feet off the couch, and plops down next to him on the love seat. Jennifer told me this one, and I can just see Jim's face. Jennifer and Tyler had a birthday party for Kaylee recently at a bowling alley when it was time to load up all those presents to his SUV. It was pouring rain. Jennifer was with Jim, and he thought Jennifer, since she had the umbrella, would follow him out into the pouring rain. But that's not what Jennifer did. She stepped under the overhang, where she would have been dry anyway, and kept the umbrella. She stayed completely dry and roared with laughter as Jim was now soaking wet, trying to load the presents while all the helium balloons were trying to get off the back of his car and trying to escape. Jennifer, you know your dad will always be with you because he already has shown you he lives. On Christmas Eve, Tyler, Jennifer, and Kaylee would come for dinner at Cindy and Jim's. And Cindy is an excellent cook. And the kids would spend the night. It was one of the traditions that was really important to Jim. After dinner, everyone would visit. But eventually, just like Kent said, eventually, it was just Jim and Tyler. They did a lot of that philosophizing stuff that you talked about. They did a lot of reminiscing. But one night, they were pleasantly shocked to realize it was already a little after 2 a.m. And they looked at each other and they realized they had better get to bed because Kaylee was going to be up in less than 5 hours and they weren't going to get any sleep. What a blessing it is when family members give each other the gift of time together. Tyler, your father-in-law loved you so much, he shared a beer or two with you and gave you that gift of time. Cindy's favorite holiday is my birthday. Not really. I thought maybe you would all want to know that and send me a card or something, but Christmas is really Cindy's favorite holiday. And it is something that she has always, always enjoyed. If you've ever been to their house over the holidays, you observe the care that went into their decorations. Jim helped Cindy with the heavy lifting, and Cindy was the detail person. Cindy created special meals to share with family. She's not allowed to change the menu because everybody wants what they had last year. Jim didn't really help prepare meals, but he was eager to help at whatever she needed. Jim did help make cookies. If you saw the video, you might have seen a couple pictures of Jim helping make spritz cookies. And I just get this vision in my mind of 6'6" Jim and this spritzer thing that's about this big, I think. And the cookies are about that big. I mean, the man can palm a basketball, you know. But their favorite, his favorite treat, though, was Jennifer's no-bake cookies. That's what he wanted. He didn't want Cindy to make them. It had to be Jennifer. But Jim and Tyler's favorite job was wrapping caramels. Cindy said as the day wore on, the guys tired of wrapping the caramels. They employed a unique way to speed up the process. No, they didn't eat them. They just kept making them bigger. Every day at 5:30 p.m., Jim would call Cindy to see how she was doing. He would ask her where she was. And Cindy, oddly enough, says most of the time, her answer was shopping. Jim pretty much guessed that, I'm sure. When Cindy became a real estate agent, at first she was nervous about getting lost and not being arriving on time. So Jim rode shotgun, gave directions, and helped her arrive on time. He then patiently waited in her car until she was finished. Jim and Cindy even developed, I remember you telling me about this, a secret so that if she was hosting an open house and she was worried about a visitor that came in, she could quickly call Jim. They actually had to use that secret code a couple of times, and of course Jim showed up. Cindy found the following words in Jim's handwriting written on a pad of paper. And it says, these are Jim's words. Love our family life together. What else is there to say? To be with you forever. That's what I always pray. I can't say it any better. Cindy, your husband states his love for you very clearly. And I seldom can look at a picture of the two of you together without recognizing the love that you're sharing. Jim's athletic career spanned many years and all different kinds of sports. Jim played basketball at the University of Dayton on a full scholarship. Did you know Jim is the only University of Dayton Flyers basketball player to be drafted by the Dallas Cowboys? He was. Jim excelled in every sport he chose to play. Football, basketball, softball, touch football, and darts. Throughout those years, Jim had two very devoted fans in the stands, cheering for Jim and his teammates. And that was Earl and Carol. Jim's brother, Don, was his teammate in some of these athletic endeavors. And Ed has described his brother as bigger than life. Jim visited his parents every day. And after his mother's passed, Jim continued to visit his father every day. Earl shared with me how he wants to remember Jim. He wants to remember him healthy. He wants to picture Jim pulling up into the driveway with Haley and then them walking up the driveway to spend time with him. Jim has touched our lives. He's touched our hearts. And because we knew him, we have loved and laughed and rolled our eyes from time to time, just like Jim. Every interaction between Jim and those of us who knew him had an impact, maybe a tiny little impact, or maybe a gigantic impact. Jim will always be with us. He has already demonstrated that this past week. Cindy and Jennifer did not know Jim's security code for his phone, and they couldn't access it. They tried birthdays, anniversary dates, his jersey numbers from a variety of sporting activities. After 10 days of trying and trying and trying, tossing numbers back and forth, they finally cracked the code. Cindy and Jennifer then each tried to take credit for this breakthrough. And I'm pretty sure it was Jim helping them out. Jim never, ever
turned on the radio, like never, not even once turned on the radio. When they drove to Disney World a few years ago, the radio was never turned on. Recently, Jennifer took Jim's vehicle for a ride. She wanted to spend some time with Jim and talk to him. At one point, Jennifer dared to turn on the radio. And she clearly heard him say, "Turn that stuff off." Jim wanted to continue his conversation with Jennifer. He didn't want to be interrupted with music. Jim loved his family very much. Jim showed his devotion to his family in a myriad of ways. And Jim wanted to spend time with his family. I'd like to share a quote by Leo Biscaglia that may help us remember that Jim is still with us in spirit. "I know for certain that we never lose the people we love, even in death. They continue to participate in every act, thought, and decision we make. Their love leaves an indelible imprint in our memories. We find comfort in knowing that our lives have been enriched by having shared their love." Thank you, Jim, for enriching all our lives.
Thank you, Mary Ray. You and Kent both introduced yourselves, so I will take the moment to introduce myself. I'm Gary Strife. I'm Cindy's first cousin, and I am older than you,
yes,
Mary Ray, and I'm the oldest of 20 friend cousins. So I appreciate it. Friends, will you join me that we might together recite the 23rd Psalm? "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Amen.
I just want to share something with you, for Jen. So I want him to know that no matter what, I know you'll always be with me. When life separates us, I know it's only your soul saying goodbye to your body, but your spirit will be with me always. When I hear the horse's hooves falling upon the ground, I know that it's you drumming in my heart. When a ladybug flies by or lands on Kaylee's arms, I will know that it's you ensuring me you're watching over her and us in our free of pain. When a gentle fragrance of a flower catches my attention, I know that it is you reminding me to appreciate the simple things in life. When the sun shines through my window, I'll feel the warmth of your love. When I hear the rain pitter-patter against my windowsill, I will hear your voice, your words of wisdom, and remember what you've taught me so well. That without rain, trees cannot grow. Without rain, flowers cannot bloom. Without life's challenges, I cannot grow. When I look out to sea, I will think of your endless love for our family. When I think of mountains, their majesty, and their magnificence, I will be reminded of the giant of a man you were in my life. No matter where I am, your spirit will be beside me. For I know that no matter what, you will always, always be with me. So those of you probably know that Jim maybe didn't think in his life he would have a daughter and a granddaughter. And he got me. So he's the best dad you could ask for. So my last one is, I will always remember your special smile and your caring heart, your warm embrace. I will always remember you being there for me through good and bad times, no matter what. I'll always remember you, Dad, because you will never be another one to replace you in my heart and the love that I have for you and that you have always had for me.
John's Gospel, we read these words of assurance. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go and prepare a place for you? If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you unto myself, that where I am, you may be also. peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Amen. I want to share with you briefly four words that I think can underline some of what has already been said. One of the scriptures that you chose was from Ecclesiastes. And the first word that I will offer to you is the word gift. For life truly is a gift. And as the writer of Ecclesiastes says, there is for each of us a time to be born, a time to die. Some poets have drawn the analogy of the two dates, our birth and our death, of the dash between, and all that fills our days. And our life itself is a gift from God. And so the first word that I would offer to you is gift. That we come today to know and understand that gift and to affirm it in the life of Jim Testerman. The hymn writer says, of seasons unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. Life is mystery as well as a gift. And so we embrace that today. But let us never forget the last words of that scripture that were read this morning. Whatever God does endures forever. Whatever God does endures forever. The second word that I would offer is the word blessed. I began to write, and I wrote you a brief note in a card this morning, and at the bottom of it, I wanted so much, and I thought, no, I need to just say it to you. In embracing Jim's love of you, Jim's love of his family, Jim's love of life, above and beyond all of that, he was blessed, and you were blessed. And we certainly come today to affirm that blessing that God has given. We also would remember that God offers us blessing always. When Jesus shared the Sermon on the Mount in the fifth chapter of the book of Matthew, he spoke about this moment when he said in the Beatitudes, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. So today is also a day of blessing. Even as Jim's life and your lives have been blessed. The third word that I would offer is the word love. You have all spoken of it over and over. And I move immediately to the letter that Paul wrote to the church at Corinth. And two of those words from the fourth chapter come out. Think about Jim for a moment and think of what Paul says. Love is patient. Love is kind. Do we see Jim? Love is patient. Love is kind. And he expressed his love in so many wonderful ways. Today, I want you to hear again from the 13th chapter of Corinthians, the 8th verse, which says this, hear it. Love never ends. Love never ends. In another beloved scripture, it says, in life and death and life beyond, nothing can separate us from the love of God. And so we know that God has enfolded Jim in his arms. That God has claimed him in love and God holds him in love. The final word that I share with you today is the word eternal. The scripture from John's Gospel says, I go to prepare a place for you. And then I will come again to take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. In my Father's house are many rooms, many dwelling places, many mansions. But it speaks about home. And ultimately, it speaks about our eternal home, that place prepared for us. Jim Testerman was a homebody, amen. He loved home. He loved being at home. He loved being with family. And so I think today it is comforting for us to hear the scripture and to know and to be able to affirm that God prepares that home for us, that place for us. And Jim is at home. And in this moment, friends, God offers you his peace. When we are in the world, when we are busy at work, we're often not at peace. And where do we go to find that peace? But at home. And so we give thanks today for that gift that was Jim's and for the life that he shared. Gift, blessing, love, and eternal promise through Jesus Christ our Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you still are God. We pray to you for one another in our need and for all anywhere who mourn with us. To those who doubt, give light. To those who have sinned, mercy. To those who are weak, strength. To all who sorrow, your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. In all our ways, we trust you. And to you, with your church on earth and in heaven, we offer honor and glory now and forever. O God, all that you have given us is yours. At first you gave Jim to us, so now we give Jim back to you. Receive Jim into the arms of your mercy. Raise Jim up with all your people. Receive us also and raise us into a new life. Help us so to love and serve you in this world that we may enter into your joy in the world to come. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, James Earl Testerman. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive Jim into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of all the saints. God of love, we thank you for all with which you have blessed us even to this day, for the gift of joy and days of health and strength, and for the gift of your abiding presence and promise in days of pain and grief. We praise you for home and friends, and for our baptism and place in your church with all who have faithfully lived and died. Above all else, we thank you for Jesus, who knows our grief, who died our death, and rose for our sake, and who lives and prays for us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and grant you peace. May the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.
Reverend Gary Strife has completed services here at the funeral home this morning for Jen. And it's come to that time we'll be going to Meadville Cemetery. We'll be having a final rite of committal there at the cemetery on the family grave. One of our staff members are going to be asking you to step by row. We're going to start from the back to the front so you can pay respects to Jim and the family. And once you've had a chance to do so, you can exit the double doors up front here on your left this morning. And if you are going to the cemetery, we're going to ask you to go ahead and step outside to your vehicles. Headlights and flashers, you should have a pendant on your vehicle as well. If you don't, you can see one of our staff about that. There have been six gentlemen honored to be casket bearers here for Jim this morning. And we want to recognize those gentlemen. And the gentlemen are Scott Nail, Tyler Olds, Kent Strife, Benny Stroop, Chris Lavelle, and Andy Olds. If you gentlemen can remain in the building, back where you came in by the guest book, we'll call for your assistance at that time. I also want to make a reminder that there will be a continued food and fellowship immediately following the burial at Meadville Cemetery today at the Averlyn Springs Clubhouse. There are directions printed out by the guest book, so if you do need those in that address, you can take one of those. And again, that will be following the burial immediately following at Meadville. So you can just remain seated. Morgan's going to start a dismissal here. Thank you.